I brought some other people in for this presentation. I'm not a technology person. I actually, when I need stuff, I just go to the kids in the school and say, hey, I need help with this, and they walk me through these problems. So I brought in Detective John Aston from State College Police Department, School Research Officer Terry Steck from State College as well, and Ken Burns from Wireless Made Simple here in town in a cell phone store. So we have lots of people to kind of give you information if you have questions. And I'm going to turn it over to Detective Aston and let him get started. And certainly if you have questions, just let us know as we go.
Thank you everyone for coming. I really appreciate it. I wish there was a few more people here, but that's fine. I should be able to field a question from everybody here. And thank you for being here. We have a couple experts in the house. There's one of them. And don't take any credit away from the two school resource officers, because I call Jason a lot and I deal with Terry on a daily basis at the high school as far as juvenile involvement and criminal activity and social media and phone issues and all the other complicated situations that arise with incidents in the high school. This presentation, I've modified it numerous times. I've had this presentation for juveniles, I've had this presentation for just law enforcement, and then for groups like this. So this presentation here, it's on a PowerPoint. I'm not strictly going to go with the PowerPoint. It's going to be on the backdrop. There's going to be a lot of talking points on the PowerPoint. Hopefully that will raise some questions. As far as the law enforcement end of it, social media is growing nonstop. Years ago, I remember I was with a group where we were trying to create a social media guidebook. Well, it's impossible, because you really need to do that almost on a weekly or monthly basis. It's growing so much. There's no way to keep hold of it. I remember back in the days of 2005 when Facebook was nice and easy, because you needed to have a .edu attached to it in order to even access it. And then in 2006, they opened it up to everyone. And that changed everything, to include new law enforcement investigations. But before we start, this is a 2010 video. It's very effective, and it still sends the same message in 2013. Just listen to this, and then we'll get started with the presentation. Thank you. anybody see that before? Want to leave lights off or on? Anybody? Is it okay for filming?
No, on is better, but.
Okay, you can leave it on. Hurts. Just real quick, there's a disclaimer on the bottom, and I would think everybody would understand this, but obviously, I'm with the State College Police Department. I don't represent anything that's being said here as far as Facebook or any of the other social media sites. All this information was obtained off of the internet and thrown into this presentation. And like I said, I've done this presentation a lot before. Some of this stuff is up to date, some of it is a little behind. If you saw the 2010 video, if you look at some of those figures, they're a lot higher than they are now. As of current March 2013, Facebook users are 1.06 billion. And those that access Facebook on their cell phones, at least 680 million. And with that said, show of hands, who has a Facebook account in here? Okay. Who has a smartphone? Who has the old style window with the phone? Anybody still have any of those?
My office phones.
Okay. But other than that, it's basically a smartphone now. And that's what we're dealing with. The days, you know, there's slides in here, and actually they need to change pretty soon because the days of people going into their home computer at home in their den or wherever it is, it's almost gone in the fact that you can get onto, you know, an iPad or a tablet. Or your smartphone and access the internet and do everything else you would be doing from your home computer, and things are changing. And you know where they're really changing? In the schools, because how many kids now have smartphones or iPods in school? That's becoming an issue because there's just a wealth of information, 32, 64 gigabytes at their disposal with the internet is an amazing amount of information that can be stored in there. And with the communications that are out there, Kick Messenger, Text Free, Text Plus, AIM, you name it. These are all free text apps that you can get for your phone outside of your conventional SMS text messaging. So what do you think? Years ago when this started, everybody was just kind of jumping on board with social media, and it's changed a heck of a lot now. Officer Steck, how many investigations have we handled in school with Facebook?
Oh my gosh, hundreds. Not prosecuted, but investigated,
yeah.
Hundreds.
I mean,
two today.
Right, I was going to say, and I don't even hear a lot. I mean, Terry, Officer Steck handles a lot of these before he even gets to me. As far as the communications, the parties that are going to be on Friday night, the drug deals that we've uncovered on Facebook, whether they're coded or not. And I could lean right over and look at you and say you probably are dealing with the exact same thing.
Yeah, parties are endless on there, and you know it's that and their cell phones.
I mean, like it says right there, it's a fundamental shift in the way that we communicate. I mean, it's like nothing we've ever had before, and it kind of caught us by storm. And like I said, back in 2005, it was nice and easy. There was Facebook. We did a lot of investigations as far as the police, and that was. You know, that was when MySpace was really popular, created in 2003, 2005 through 2008. It was really, really popular, and then it's declined. Now there's 25 plus million users. But Facebook has taken over the entire social media network. So how big is it? And this is only probably a third of what is out there. There's a site out there called Traffic. It's TRAFF, I think IKD, and it lists all the updated social media sites on a daily basis. I just got on there today, and it's just amazing, everything on there. And what's really nice about it tells you, and it breaks it down by category: recreation, religion, household, vacationing, pets, you name it, it's all on there. As far as the police and why do we use it? Well, there's a number one. It's a free online database. there's a lot of information. Any job applicant, and this doesn't go for police, this goes anywhere, any job applicant now, how many employers are going to look at social media, right? You're shaking your head. You probably do, right? It's standard.
We were hiring for our drug and alcohol office, and I can assure you the gentleman whose Facebook page had him stand next to a keg did not get invited for an interview.
It's not a good thing.
No.
Well, that's right, and that's what we use that. Now, what has changed over the years, in 2005, 2006, everybody basically had what they called an open site. Privacy controls were really low. Anybody could get on there, they could access your pictures, your wall, and see anything that's on there. That has since changed. The curve has went the other way, and now sites are blocked. They're closed sites, and you have to be invited to get in, and people will allow you to get in. So there's no magical back door for police, so to speak, as far as accessing somebody's social media site. We have to do it through legal process, through a court order, a search warrant to actually get those records to find out the information that's held within the Facebook account. But that stuff is still there. But there's still, it still amazes me. Every time I have an investigation, I start the normal process of going through our database and searching through the person and going through a couple other websites. And I also try Facebook. I use a search engine called people.com. It's P-I-P-L. Has anybody ever used that before or heard about it? I actually tested it tonight, and I tested your name just to see.
I wasn't there.
No, what it does is it basically will link names to everything that you've registered for. MySpace, you were under LinkedIn. Mm-hmm. You have a LinkedIn account. So that's how I picked him up. So it's a real interesting site. You can get a lot of different information. Now, there's a heck of a lot of Jason Browers, and the first couple came up as an obituary, so I knew I had to keep going.
Yeah, I didn't read myself this morning, so I must have been.
As far as the legal issues, you know, within the school, and we're going to get into this a little bit, with the cyberbullying and the bullying campaign, the anti-bullying campaign, there is countless cases. There's a few listed on here, and again, it's another thing I just typed in the other day and checked again. All the number of basically bullied to death incidents across the country with the cyberbullying, with the Facebook and the other social media sites. That I'm not saying weren't addressed properly, but there was a lot of red flags there that were missed. And a lot of these kids as young as age 8 have committed suicide due to some of the bullying in school and outside of school. But what makes it really dangerous now is it can be outside of school because of the social media. Because of the Wi-Fi, because of iPods, you know, I'm assuming Wi-Fi is locked down in the school, is that correct?
Correct.
So if you bring your iPod in, you can access the school's Wi-Fi or you need to?
You should not be able to.
Should not be able to, okay.
You need a password.
Okay, so phones are still there, but for those that just have an iPod, as soon as they get back home and connect to their home on Wi-Fi, there starts the messaging, the pictures, the chats, and all that other stuff that's going to be bombarded when the student returns home. Some of the benefits. Well, what started with social media to allow some of these benefits, it's a great communication tool, but also allows a lot of the kids that don't normally fit in the regular school parameters in one of the social groups, they can access the social media and get into certain groups that aren't publicized or are not well known or are not talked about too much within school. As well, you can get in and look at all the different hobbies within the different sports, recreation, pictures. There's so many websites out there now. Has anybody ever heard of Tumblr? Pinterest? Pinterest is growing leaps and bounds. The interesting thing I found about Pinterest, and this is following people when you post photos, is 80% of all the photos are repints. So there's only 20% originality on Pinterest, but it's growing on a daily basis. Little to no supervision, and that goes back to let's get rid of even the fact that there were cell phones in the house before cell phones, and that's with the computers, with the supervision. You know, I always used to, back before this even started, parents would say, well, how do I monitor my children's activity? Well, put the computer in a part of the house, not in their bedroom, where, you know, it's accessed where everybody can see it, and that kind of cuts down on that. Those days have changed, because really now with the advent of smartphones and then social media and the ease and the access to get on these, you know, get into a Wi-Fi at McDonald's, at Starbucks, at all the different other open Wi-Fi sites, you can access that outside of school, outside of parents, outside of adult supervision, and the eyes of adults to monitor some of these things that are going on. Like I said, there's a lot of slides here. I'm going to go through some of them, and there's some key interest points here that I want to bring up. And if there's any questions as we go through this, anything that comes up, that please raise your hand. I mean, this isn't wait to the end to ask all these questions. There's a lot of information that I'm going to be throwing out to you here. I'm going to ask you a real quick question here. Number of smartphones that are sold in your store per month, if you have that?
About 100 to 150, depending on the month. That's a pretty typical month. It's not anything, you know, it's not like Christmas time, that was probably 200 to 300.
Yeah, that's
and
a lot.
And we're a small store. We're not open Sundays, we're not open after 6 o'clock. You know, we're not like the mall that's open 9 to 9, and they're open Sundays and Sundays.
Yeah, it's amazing. I just got back, I was at a cell phone training last week in Tennessee, and I just sat in the airport for a little while and I just watched everybody, and I was waiting for my flight, and I saw this, and this was from everybody. This was from married couples, families, strangers, business partners. This is what I saw. Everybody's doing this. People are literally walking the airport doing this, typing, or on the phone or the headset. I'm walking by, I turn around and start speaking to somebody that I thought was talking to me, and they're just talking away. That's what I saw. And I actually absorbed and I started watching. I said, this is amazing. I'm just looking around and everybody has a smartphone and everybody's digging into it. And as far as the social communication was going on, there was zero. It was absolutely amazing to see. So, I mean, things have absolutely changed. Socializing behind a keyboard or our smartphone is really what it's come down to. Downtown State College on a Friday, Saturday night, 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, another amazing phenomenon. Groups of 3, 4, 5 people are no longer walking and just chatting and discussing things. They're walking, texting, and talking on the phone. And my question is, who are they talking to at that time of the night? And what happened to this conversing with everybody? I mean, everybody is locked in a cell phone. Matter of fact, there's more people that I stopped that absolutely have a cell phone on before they have their identification on. And I mean, it's just amazing. They cannot leave home without their cell phone. I mean, how many people left for work and turn around and come back and say, I forgot my cell phone? I mean, it's happened to everybody. You absolutely have to have it, and you feel lost without it.
Or take a 16-year-old, just throw it away from them and watch them lose their mind. They will.
It's interesting you say 16-year-old, because I bet we could go a lot lower.
Oh, I'm sure, but that's about the age where we see a lot of it. It's like, oh, my phone broke. What am I going to do?
That's the place.
You're going to actually talk to someone.
I was going to say, there's another group of experts that we're not tapping into, and that is juveniles, and that is high schoolers, those that have the smartphones and know all these, you know, specific details about how these phones work. For example, I'll throw this one out to you if anyone's ever heard of it, Snapchat. Show of hands, who has never heard of Snapchat?
I didn't hear of it until last Thursday when you brought it up to me, but I did some research on it.
In short, I'm a drug dealer, okay, and you want to buy some drugs from me. You don't trust me too well. I'm going to take a picture, okay? But I've downloaded the app for Snapchat, and so have you. So I'm going to take the picture of the drug that I'm selling to you. And I'm going to send it to you. And you're going to look at it. And when you look at it, you have a expiration time of looking at it. 12 seconds?
You can set it.
You can set it.
Up it's to 20 seconds.
Yeah,
20 is the max, right?
20 is the max.
Yeah.
So you see it. As soon as you see it, it's done. It's never going to be on your phone again. It's over. Now, we just communicated with each other. I sent you a message of the goods that you're supposed to buy from me, but there's no evidence of it.
And there's no way to track it back.
There is a way to track it, but this is what's really interesting. I'll be able to, through call records, through the historical on the phone to get the records, know that data was sent from my phone to your phone, and that she received it, but that's it. That on this date and this time, I sent data, but there'll be no image. Nor will there be an image if I do a forensic analysis on the phone.
And then, you know, we go app to app. It's not like you can't Snapchat to like a Facebook page?
No. No, because that's how Snapchat works. And there's another one out there, I think it's called Wicker. similar. So you can see where Snapchat, if we want to throw it into the realm of high school and middle school, sexting, and where that becomes a problem. And I, without getting into details, you had something similar, but what's the new thing that's happening now?
Well, I had one yesterday. It was a 14-year-old student girl was badgered until she finally sent her boyfriend a topless picture of herself using Snapchat, and that was the agreement that it would be done with Snapchat, that way the photo wouldn't stay anywhere. Well, the boy who was receiving the photo was with other boys at a sleepover, and they had another phone prepared for when the Snapchat came in. So when the Snapchat came in, before it was able to self-destruct, they took a still of the Snapchat photo with another phone, and then it was captured, and obviously it was passed around once the boyfriend and girlfriend broke up, like it always does.
Right.
So they were able to still secure that image, even though the girl thought she was Snapchatting and it was going to be gone. They were able to capture the image because they knew it was coming, and they were prepared for it, and they took a quick photo of it.
So if we had 75% everybody in here raise their hand and say they knew what Snapchat is, but if you asked that question in class, you'd probably have about 100% saying they know what it is.
They're doing what they're cheating on tests with it. They're snapping answers to each other. And there's no way of proving it once the picture's gone in 15 seconds.
I'm not going to go into some of the history here. This is interesting stat, and this stat has grown a little bit. Right there, 0 to 17, 15%, actually above the 18 to 24-year-old for use. I don't know of any, you know, and you guys would see, I don't know of any high school kid right now that doesn't have a phone. Is that?
I just got done doing fifth grade in all the schools except Benner. I go to Benner next week. But I've been to all the schools in our district, all the elementary schools, down to fifth grade. And about three quarters of every fifth grader has a phone.
That's fifth grade?
Fifth grade.
Smartphone or regular phone?
Most are smartphones, not all.
Those that don't have a smartphone have an iPod.
Or, which makes up for the
some other sort of device like that.
100% iPod. 100% of 100%
of them have some way to communicate, whether it be via an iPhone, an iPod, or smartphone, or something.
The Kindles, you can do with the Kindles and things.
iPads.
Yeah,
and all they need is the app, and the apps are free, and they're out there. You know, you type them the right thing. So they all have a. I mean, I did them with Officer Brower, two of the schools. And they all, to a class, have some sort of texting communication to use.
Now, we have it set up in my house where my wife has an iPad, my son has an iPod, but any app that he downloads will instantly go to my wife's as well. So it's a checks and balances in and of itself. It's all synced. Not, I don't want to call it a family plan, but it's all synced in the house under our home computer. And that's a good way of keeping, an eye on what is being downloaded and what's being viewed, because it's going to get all your photos. If you sync it, it's going to get all your music, all your videos, all your web browsing. And you know, with the iPods, the iPods basically were around and more popular at the time, way before the smartphones. Yes.
I have a question. Is there, like, I have done that with my daughters where everything she does goes to my iPad.
Okay.
But can you have, like, if she has an account, my son has an account, can I put his, because I think we'll figure out how to get the second one to go to my iPad.
Do you have a home computer?
We have wireless.
Okay, so if you sync them all on the same account.
On the same iTunes account or on the same wireless?
Same iTunes account.
You can only have one iTunes account per device, so to speak. Well, per like computer device. Now, like he was saying, I have my son's, my wife has my daughter's, but we have two separate computers in which we're able to have those accounts. So when we add our third child, that's going to create the problem. You know, but that's the way that it works. So everything that my son wants to do on his iPod now magically comes to here in my iPad. Gets a little much, but having two accounts on the same iTunes can't be done. iTunes doesn't allow for that.
Well, when you register the device, though, keeping with the same email, like it would be your email and your password, So any app that my son wants to download, he has to go find my wife. She has to enter her password before he can even get into it. But anyway.
But if your son has his own and your daughter has her own, then they're two separate accounts and they don't.
Right, and that's what I'm saying. I could figure out how to get his online. I could get hers online.
Yeah, so I mean, that's, you know, for those that have Apple products, but.
I was gonna say, there's not, does Android have anything that's similar to that?
For syncing capabilities, I'm not sure how the tablet would work with a phone. I mean, obviously you can sync all of them together, but I don't know if you could sync it where it would be the checks and balances to see what they're putting onto the phone.
Very similar, not quite the same.
Okay.
Since it's all Google-based, it's all open source, you're looking, if you have the same Google account on each one, then yes. But a Google account is a lot easier to make than an iTunes account. Since it's all open source, I could, I could sit down right now and make 20 Google accounts if I wanted to have it all done. Yes, it can be done, but it's a lot easier to break it on an Android than it is on an iPhone. In that respect.
That's a good question. Social network categories, I go the same with that traffic before. This is kind of similar. This is really small to see, but it just, it's massive. It's absolutely massive what is out there. And you know how you do this? You explore. You get on there and you have, and you explore and you find these different sites that are out there. And when you go onto them, I mean, Google is a great search engine. And you can find out a lot of information on there as to what these different social sites are about. This is a breakdown of a lot of the different social media around the world. Facebook in 2013 has taken over as being the most sourced social media. Third of the population, at least monthly, and I would say it's higher than that now. As far as the social media, you know, again, why do we use it? Police, because it's an investigative tool that just houses a lot of information. You know, what used to be stored on someone's home computer is now stored on their phone, but is now also stored on social media sites. Like I said, when you go into People, the PIPL, or the Spookio.com, you're able to get a glimpse of a lot of the different activities that people are now involved in before you never knew about. And it's just a wealth of information. I mean, in law enforcement, we strive on information for an investigation to build our investigation, maybe to go a different way to find out a lead or corroborate information we have or dispel some of the information we may have. And these are all at our fingertips for what we use. And it's amazing what you will find on people's social media sites as well as their smartphones. I do cell phone forensics. Like I said, I just came back from a second week-long forensic training class, and I average anywhere from 3 to 5 cell phones a week as far as analysis on them through our department and assistance with other Center County law enforcement. And what's the number one thing that you think I find on someone's phone? Take a guess. Anybody? Somebody has to have a guess. What's that?
Their home phone number and address.
No, I guess let's change the question. Bad question.
I'll probably make it pictures of you.
Yeah.
That's what we see a ton of it, and I'm amazed that people just, they get a new phone, they hand us their old phone, say, "You're rid of it," and I say, "Great, we clear it out." And it's stunning. Yes.
Yeah, that's the number one thing that's found on phones, and this is, you know, high school all the way up is what's on these phones.
Middle school all the way up.
You're right, middle school. You're right, because we have worked the case.
Yes. Yeah, we've had that problem here this year, all the way down to about 7th grade.
You had said that if my Facebook account is protected, you can't access it. But if I'm friends with Beth, and she can share what I've posted with you, even though you can't access me directly.
Very good. So that's why I'm friends with Beth. That, and you know what, that can happen. You know, you're right, it's like, you know, you gotta attack from a different angle. And if you can access that way by going in a, you know, back door, so to speak, which would be another friend. But again, it would be, you know, the friend would be there allowing you to get in to see some of this. And we have that a lot, you know, somebody will come in, the reporter, and say, hey, this was on my Facebook, or this was on this person's Facebook, it's pictures of me, or it's this threat, you know, well, I can't access that. They just get on it and show us, you know, and we get screenshots and so forth.
Are you able, is some software, so for instance, my phone is password protected, are you able to then get through the password protection?
Sometimes. I'll just leave it at that.
I'm just curious because, like, you have a lot of work information, people have emails and all kinds of stuff on their phones for privacy reasons. I was walking in case I leave it somewhere.
And I think that's the smartest idea, okay. Because you're right. Everybody carries one, and everybody puts everything on, you know, to include bank accounts, and I mean everything, you know, when you think about it. So sure, why wouldn't you want a password to protect all that? But with the advent of cell phones, there's cell phone forensics, which is what I'm involved in now. And there's a lot of utilities that are out there that are that can access phone and bypass certain passwords, and can extract a lot of the data on your phone to include deleted data. But you dropping your phone out in public, you know, you're not going to have anyone access it. You have someone turn it in, the police, to, you know, turn it into the police, we could pretty much find out and get it back to you. I mean, number one way.
Actually, we can do that too. The store, because all we do is find the serial number on the back of the phone, and we call up the carrier and say, hey, we found this serial number on the back of this phone. Can you come, and they can look it up with the serial number, find who owns the phone, call them up for us and say, let them know we have their phone. We've done that.
But they don't give you access.
No, we don't get any access to it, but we call them up and say, hey, we found, you know, this serial number on this phone. Can you contact the person, let them know we have it at our store, and then tell the person to contact us, and they will.
We have cell phones that are turned in. You know, the first thing I do before getting into even hooking it up to any machines or doing any of the stuff that I use, I go to emergency call and dial and call dispatch. Dispatch gives me the phone number, you know, and 75% of the time we are able to access who that person is through that. Because of our database, we're going through one of our search engines that we use within the police department, we can access phone number or find out the person.
If you're, I have an app that I use on my phone where if you do lose it and you're really concerned, you could do a remote wipe on it. Where if you would log on to a computer, you type in a password, it'll erase everything off your phone.
I'm just always surprised.
Find Microwave, I think.
Yeah, we did. Look at another one.
Yeah, I think it's under 5.
Yeah, I was going to say, here's an expert on dealing with this, but you're right. I guess there's a couple things. You have on your phone a factory reset, and you can do it manually, or you, if you lose your phone, there's certain things you can do. I have one as well, and you can send text messages to it. For example, I usually always leave my phone on vibe, so the first time I text a special message, it will ring for, I think, 2 minutes. The second time, it activates my GPS if I don't have it, and the third time, it's a remote wipe. Well, it's an app killer, Find My Droid, for what I have. Apple has, actually it's built into Apple
yeah,
now.
Yeah, it's built into
After
Apple.
After iPhone 4, it's standard.
In fact, there's an app in there now where if you lose your phone and someone else picks up and tries to use your password, it'll take a picture using the front-facing camera of that person and email it to the person that owns the phone.
And we've had investigations like that. Now, the fun thing is we have investigations like that where you get a screenshot of, you know, type them. It helps with the investigation, but still it doesn't give you the person's name at the bottom, but it definitely helps. We've had countless investigations where someone's iPhone was lost or stolen, they reported it, they were able to get on the computer and find out where their phone was through GPS. And we have done play-by-play tracking just based on what they already have on their phone. Got us right to the restaurant or the apartment, wherever they were. I had a burglary investigation last year, the year before, where an iPad was stolen, and he had the app on there to find out, and right down in Philadelphia. And it was a weekend visitor who, on Sunday after football game, left and decided to take his duffel bag and other people's property from another apartment and tracked it right down to the house in Philadelphia.
Did it have to be turned on? Like, would the iPad have to be turned on, or if it was powered down?
It has to be turned on. It has to be turned on.
And have Wi-Fi, and be connected to Wi-Fi?
No, no, no. GPS does not run on Wi-Fi.
Oh, no, great, thank you.
Yeah.
I just looked on my iPhone, and there's a passcode lock, and if I click one of the buttons, it literally says, erase data on this phone after 10 failed passcodes.
Right, a lot of people have that set up. That's why in policing, I always tell, you know, officers sometimes when they get it.
I forget my passcode.
Well, that's, yeah, you're right.
That's why I'm not turning it on.
Right, again, you can set, and these privacies, which is really interesting, these privacies land all the way back to what we're talking about with the social media sites, with your privacy levels. You know, I would think for this day and age, your social media privacy settings should be at max and only allow, you know, trusted people in there. But you're right, you know, you have 10 friends and they access it, and, you know, somebody can always go in through a side door to see some of this stuff. But like I said, for phones, with all the information that's out there now, that's really important to do that. That's a good question, though. Here's one teenager with unusual online job description, caught selling drugs using PayPal to accept payment. And I had one several years ago, which I found really interesting. And it was when phones were becoming a little popular, but what they were doing, they weren't bringing the drugs into school. They were photocopying the drugs with a color photocopy and just bringing a picture of the goods in the school. That way, not in possession of it while in school. So it's clever. There's a lot of different things that happen. Nowadays with the phones, there it is, you know, Snapchat's one of the bigs. Another disturbing yet interesting fact, over 90,000 registered sex offenders found on MySpace. That's 90,000 registered sex offenders. That's not dealing with any of those that are not registered or have not been caught yet. Now granted, MySpace is nowhere near in popularity as it used to be with Facebook. I don't have the Facebook stats. The last incident there, and like I said, I could fill PowerPoints with all the incidents from, let's go back 2005 on. I think there's an average right now of maybe 14 to 20 known suicide deaths per year based on bullying through the teen population, anywhere from 8 to 17. The college student commits suicide after roommate live streams a sexual encounter over the internet. This is where he committed suicide jumping off of a bridge, if anybody's familiar with that. Bullied to death. Some past bullying incidents, like I said, there's a whole lot of them. The Phoebe Prince 2010 suicide. In that case, three adults, six juveniles faced criminal prosecution. And in that case, with the investigations, Facebook and Craigslist didn't cooperate in the fact that they needed to use proper legal process to get a lot of the information, and at that time the police were expecting all that stuff to be turned over due to the fact it was an investigation. So there's no doubt that Facebook and all the other social media sites do protect your privacy, but through legal process and a criminal investigation, you can definitely get it. Carl Joseph Walker Hoover, 11-year-old. Down at the bottom, 10-year-old Ashlyn Connor, bullied to death in November. Another hanging incident, November of 2011, and the list just keeps going. There's a lot of them out there. Again, with the advent of social media and the ease of communicating, you know, in your bedroom at night, you know, saying these things and bullying these kids, not in an open classroom, is where it happens.
John, can I stop you?
Sure, absolutely. Yeah.
John mentioned, just reminded me of something, he mentioned in your bedroom at night. I do a lot of presentations like Jason does to the kids, and you ask them how many people have, you know, laptops or smartphones, and how many of them have access to them in their room, and almost all of them do. Almost all of them have internet. Everybody's wireless now, mostly. So all these kids are using their laptops and their smartphones in their bedrooms, you know, all hours of the night. You don't know what they're doing. You assume that they're in their room constantly, and they're on at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning. As far as phones go, you Verizon or AT&T?
We used to go everybody, yeah, that was turned into.
Okay, I had both, I do have both still, but AT&T, I know, when my kids were a little bit younger, if you go onto the parental controls on their site, you can limit when the kids can text and receive calls on the phones. You can set it so Monday through Friday after 9 p.m. at night, they can't receive calls or they can't send calls or get texts until 6 o'clock the next morning. And if you want to make it to 11 on weekends, you can set it that way. You can also have that set up that they can receive calls from certain numbers during that time. So if you want to still be able to call them, if you want your parents to be able to call them, you know, important contacts. So you could limit that phone for certain hours to only be able to communicate with certain people. And I used that for a couple of years until I forgot I had it on there. I'm 19 years old. I'm like, hey, I'm going to need a text and they're calling.
Verizon does that,
yeah,
also.
The Verizon does it. Yeah. It's a great feature. Yeah. And so if they're in their bedrooms at 10 o'clock at night, you know that they're not using their phone to text or send photos or make calls. So, I mean, obviously they can find their way around with iPods and things like that, but if their main communication is a smartphone, you can't limit that. So.
If you know, do you access on the phone or do you access on your account?
On your computer, you can go on there and set up there.
Actually, with Verizon, they have a mobile app now that you can go parent to their phone and stop it right off the spot.
And that's really interesting.
Just to add on, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I would just say that's a nice feature.
Just to add on that, a lot of the incidents that Officer Stackman probably, you know, the bulk of that I'm dealing with when it comes to bullying and cyberbullying is all occurring at home. None of it's occurring at school because they're not using their cell phones most of the time during the school hours to bully each other. They have person to person during those hours. It's after school, in the evenings, on the weekends. That's when this correspondence is taking place and then rolling into school the next day when they get there. And then we have, you know, with them, that's when we encounter our problems. So a lot of this is happening, not on necessarily the school's watch, but it's happening at home. And I think that sometimes is what we don't realize, and I know that's one of my elementary issues right now, why I was called to do fifth grade. I was actually contacted by the schools to do fifth grade this year because of iPods. Because parents aren't all aware that iPods will do the same thing as a cell phone when it comes to texting. They give them their iPods thinking they're just listening to music, and they're not. They've downloaded apps, they're smart, they know what they're doing, they talk to their friends, they download these apps, and they can now text. And they're using it, even at fifth and fourth grade, to text each other and bully each other. And it's not happening in school, it's happening at home, because they're not allowed to have their iPods, you know, on their persons in school. So that becomes an issue for all of us, not necessarily a school problem. It's a home problem, but it's rolling into our schools and every facet of where we are.
Yeah, Sir Brar is correct. Unfortunately, it's they call it 365, 24/7, because they can use them during the school day there. And they can access the Wi-Fi. What they do is they send their, whatever their EIN, whatever number it is, on their phone or the device to the IT people at the school. They send an email to the parents saying your child has requested this device be allowed to access the system at school, and they give them permission. Then we have all kind of devices on. We have iPods on. Any personal device they can bring in and use. So we're encountered constantly now at night in school. So,
and there are more schools going to that method than there are not anymore.
They see it as a cost-saving measure.
It's becoming so expensive to outfit schools with computers and laptops, and the technology is growing much faster than we can keep up with it, as we all know. So a lot of schools have brought in bring your own devices. And we are currently working on that in our district, but it's you're kind of at the mercy of what that student brings in, whether it be a smartphone, an iPod, or things of that nature. So there's a lot of things that go along with that, and districts are finding that it's actually becoming a more economical way to give these kids access to the internet, because they can sit in a class and that teacher doesn't have to take them all to a computer lab. You know, and they don't have to all then sign on. They can all just pull out their phones and start researching away. So when you look at, you know, some of those cost factors, that is true. It's becoming a cost.
It is, and I think State College's goal is to eventually eliminate them providing the technology at all for the most part, as far as laptops. It'll be, I mean, they'll have some available to people who don't have them, But I think for the most part, it will be, as they keep phasing old computers out, they're not replacing old ones with new ones. I think they're going with, and it is good in a way, but it's also, you don't know what they're bringing in on the computer, and that's the issue. With that, you don't know, sure, some of them, we know some of them are bringing porn in that's already on their device. So it's, you know, it's a juggling act, and it's, you know, it is a cost-saving move. It really does, it saves. It's just a matter of trying to manage it and efficiently control it.
It's a juggling act. It's a learning curve with a lot of trial and error, I think, for many, many years to come.
Now, correct. Now, would they still be subject to the filters that the school district is if they're...
Well, that's one of the issues, is that they can be, but they already know ways around them.
No, they just
filters.
Yeah,
I mean, they can
override.
It doesn't matter whether they sit down to a computer or they have their smartphone or iPod, whatever it may be. A lot of them know how to get around the filters anyway. I used to deal with that a lot.
Yeah.
And on top of that, once it kind of goes wireless, when you're sitting at a computer, you can track where that computer goes. You know, you can sit and you can go back and say, well, that computer accessed this and this and this. When it goes wireless, there's no way to, you know, every single one of us who have a smartphone in here are out there. I mean, your phone is right now connected in some way, shape, or form. And so to try to track everybody sitting in this room and what things their phone is picking up right now is next to impossible.
Can I ask you a question? What district are you in?
Belfont.
Because my son accesses Wi-Fi, so I'm not sure I understood what you said. Because he accesses Wi-Fi with his iPod, and I asked why he's allowed to do that, and they said it was impossible to put a password for everybody. So all the students, as far as I'm concerned, have access to Wi-Fi in the Belfont School District. So I'm surprised
what
that
school?
You said that. He's in high school.
There's a BASD guest account you can sign into.
I thought that was password protected.
Yeah, you just take your regular login and you just sign in through password.
Well, if you log in, then exactly why we're here.
But so you guys are saying that you log in like you do on a school machine.
Yeah.
Well, then that tells us that they've logged in. We can't necessarily track
the cellular
sites than the cellular stuff that they go to, but we can then go back and, you know, in Caleb's case, for example. I know that he signed in to there at this time.
Because data plan is harder than
if
you sign
filter, but
if it's a data plan, then
that's all I do. I only do it at lunch.
Okay, so then he's signing in with whatever the school district gave him. So
I think so.
Still,
you can do Snapchat.
He has an account.
At lunch,
he has a password.
We can track his use.
So we can still see that he's signing in and off of our wireless.
And then when you have filters,
you just
show.
I'm not sure.
Should. I don't know that they can see how they
yeah.
where they go, but the filter should still be
not tomorrow,
right.
You come back.
I assume that was right. The computers of the user. I didn't realize his iPod would be able to access.
If it's a wireless active device, it can go out. Somebody told me one time, and just try it, walk down the streets of Belfont and see how many wireless connections you can pick up.
There are places you can get up to 5.
They have
I can tell you right now, at our store, I can pick up 50.
Yeah, I know.
At our store. And I'm on the corner of Cushion Valley. We have apartments above us I can get. I have businesses beside us we can get. I can get mom and the creatures across the street. So,
and many of them are free. I mean, they don't lock them down. So, you know, that's why they have the Starbucks and all those. You can just go in. You don't need anything. Now, these guys, now they are still logging in via their district information. So we still, I can see how that is still somewhat tracked from the standpoint that they know they're getting.
And it should still be filtered.
And it should be filtered.
So as a parent, can I request that he doesn't have access to the internet or Wi-Fi at the school? I don't know how that would affect his classes, but
you would take him out of our.
Yes and no. Yeah. Yes, but could severely limit some of
what
he can do for classes at times. I mean, there are teachers who use software that requires a login, and so yes, it can be done, but it would hinder them.
Well,
and
that's the
issue with the iPods, that a lot of, I think, parents all the way down into elementary schools aren't realizing. They're thinking it just does music.
Yeah. It's not like
that is not true. That is the furthest thing from the truth. It does everything except make a phone call.
And even then, there's an hour.
And that's, I was going to say, and that's not true because
you can Skype on those.
You can live chat.
Voice over on them. You can live instant. What we call it instant messenger. You know, it is a phone without.
Ken, how many apps did you find for Skyping type apps that you find that are free?
About the social networking, I just went to iTunes today and looked up social networking top 10 free apps. What do you think Facebook is at? And then being number 8. So kids aren't going on Facebook anymore. Vine, have you ever heard of Vine?
What is it?
It's called Vine.
V-I-N-E?
It is, the short of it is, it's Twitter for video. Twitter, you can do a little message and blast it out to everybody. Vine is a 6-second video that you can just share any way you want. It's just a little video thing. That's number one. That just came out 2 months ago. Twitter just released that.
So it's kind of like Snapchat, only it's videos instead of pictures?
Yeah, but the video doesn't go away.
Yeah.
But the video doesn't.
It's like Twitter, and that it doesn't go.
The length of the video is six seconds.
That's your maximum length on
it,
yes.
Like I said, you want to tap into what's hot right now.
Ask
the kids.
Yeah.
Or you look at their phone and go through all their apps.
Look up the top 10.
Yeah.
Because that's, you think Facebook would be number one. That's not even close. There are other apps I never even heard of that were up above Facebook. I just kind of read about it. Kick Messenger, I never even
heard. Oh, yeah, Kick Messenger is really popular.
I think more and more Facebook is for older
people. That's mom and dad are getting into Facebook with their kids, and the kids are like, I don't want to be hanging out with mom and dad on here. This is my space.
Twitter to them is more immediate.
Yeah.
Right. You know, Twitter is more how they communicate today than, at least that's where we were going. Now some of these other things,
right?
But there's somebody right now sitting at a computer thinking up a new app. So give it 2 days and something else will be added.
With all the phones I do for high school and early college, is Kick Messenger. It's really, really popular. It's really easy to use. I have it on my phone. I try to download all the apps that I see so I can try to understand. The problem is I get a lot of these apps. I just can't go out and communicate with everybody because other people don't have it, but I have test groups that I try. But Kick Messenger is great in the fact that, attach photos video to it very quickly over your standard conventional text messaging, which you got to backtrack and go into your files. It's just a lot harder and a lot slower. Kick Messenger is very fast. Everybody has it on their phone.
So it's not even enough to just check your kids' text messages. Because chances are they're using 5 or 6 different apps and doing the same thing.
And text messaging you can set for 30 messages and then it deletes and overwrites. Yeah. And there's so many, like I said, the standard I think everybody has in here on their smartphone is go to your text button and send a text to somebody. But that's old school.
We're old fashioned.
It is, in the fact, because you have Text Free and Text Plus and Orchid and Kick Messenger. I mean, there's so many out there, and that's on scratching the surface with all the ones that are out there, and they're free apps.
Did Kick Messenger go to an iPod as well?
Yes, it's, yes. Yeah.
I have a question. I have to leave to pick my son up. But a coworker of mine, her daughter received a harassing phone call. And the voice was disguised. But somehow it got forwarded through her father's phone to her daughter. So like the calling number appeared to be her dad calling and it wasn't her dad.
Yeah, spoofing.
So how, is there a way to block that? Like obviously I want my son's number to pop up. That
very, very difficult spoofing.
Yeah, we've had a big problem with that this year in our district here. We've got a lot of different phone calls.
I was getting 10 to 15 spoof prank calls a day to this building, to various teachers, into their classroom, getting past the, and they're using them to spoof things, and I had the phones trapped. There's a thing called trapping your phone line. And the trap couldn't identify.
It gives you a number? But the number could be
anything
pulled from anywhere.
Well, and the number will also then be filtered through the spoofing site itself.
you can set someone up, right? Put someone's phone
number
in.
Yeah, we've had that happen a lot.
You can put anybody's phone number into it.
Very difficult.
But there's no way to block his number from being.
I'm not going to block it.
I don't know.
Well,
either.
The problem is they're just using
a different number.
Yeah, they're just moving a different number the next time.
It's a building level. I don't
know.
It's a
long and tedious paper trail backwards to try to decipher where it came from. It can happen. It has happened, but it's not easy.
Because I'm just thinking, you don't want him to get caught, like someone to send it to someone else,
right.
Thinking it's, you know what I mean, that he wasn't involved.
Yeah,
just
you know, the thing
protected.
Is, you go to the Play Store or to the App Store and type in, you know, phone spoofing.
It's easy enough to prove it wasn't the person who'd be accused.
Oh, right.
You've done that because you can just get their phone records from the
right.
Month. It'll show you if they're actually making calls.
Yeah,
so,
that's usually the best. You're
yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Investigation wise, what you're basically doing at this point is proving that
who
person
didn't
do it,
did, yeah.
Not who did.
Yeah.
So there's a way to prove they did.
They did.
Sure.
Yeah,
yeah,
we just accessed their phone records and it's going to show on there where they made phone calls
right.
To. If they don't show up to this particular place, then obviously they didn't do it.
Because their phone, their records will still show dialing that number they're dialing. Because it's still making the phone's making that call to that person's number. It's just showing up as a different number.
Right.
So it'll still show an outgoing call to that number. And if they don't have it, that means it wasn't their phone going. So.
You know, to complicate the situation a little bit, text-free, for example, if you get on an app to text-free and start your text-free, you know, you can download all your contacts in there. If you send me a message, it's going to come up with a phone number. You know, an 814, usually text-free right now, it's like the 499s. It's a phone number. But you call that phone number back. It's just, that's how they associate, and that's how it's sent through. So again, it's just another thing that complicates, because if you're going to see that on your phone with the number, it doesn't, you know, unless that person has the app that allows for the phone calls. And I think text-free, if I'm not mistaken, allows you phone calls in the beginning, and then it runs out, and you have to pay for it after, I don't know how many calls you get, a few, but a lot of complicated technical portions when you start digging into some of these apps, you know, as far as the how they're covered, so to speak.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? Let's keep moving here. There's, like you said, there's a lot of sites here, or excuse me, a lot of pages here. There's one, I don't think, yeah, here it is. Parents on Vacation. Go to pleaserobme.com. Not as popular as it used to be, but again, you know, one time people would put on, I'll be out of town for 2 weeks, you know, watch the dogs or whatever, and there's sites out there to pick up on this type of information, and we'll post that. Pictures taken of stolen property, that's been very successful on my end over the years for some of the photos that have been out there. Facebook login, if I'm not mistaken, that changed. This country would be the third largest. I don't want to go on record on that, but I think it's now gone down to the second, if I'm not mistaken. Must be at least 13 years old, so they say, and there's terms of service, the TOS with all the different websites. You know, anybody can come up with a fictitious website, or excuse me, a social media site, just put the name and anything you want to put in there. And that's sometimes another, you know, hinder that we deal with in law enforcement. When we do get the records back, it's coming back to a fictitious account, which happens, you know, a lot of different times.
We used to be able to shut down sites of kids on MySpace. A school official,
mm-hmm.
I'm assuming Facebook doesn't have anything like that.
No.
We used to be, if we had, you know, information where a student was harassing someone or doing something bad on MySpace, we could actually call a number and have it shut down.
Yeah, I think it's an all, I'm not exactly sure. I have, for example, in the police department a couple years ago, our IT department shut down Facebook to all users, to include the police, but that hindered our investigation. We tried to get on there. They accessed and allowed us to get back on, and so they can filter through IT means, but I don't know how Facebook can do that.
I had a situation where I had a fake Facebook account created of one of
you just violated their terms of service.
of one of the guys that I coached with. And I called, I emailed, my wife can attest to it,
we did everything we could to contact Facebook about, I mean, it was bad. It was,
so somebody had used his name to create
right.
Right. And the pictures and the posts and it wasn't until I found the kid that did it that I was able to remove the site. No, there wasn't a single phone call that ever got answered. There wasn't a single email message. They say, you know, this is a bad site. Click here to report. You know, they didn't care. This went on for weeks until I finally was able to figure it out and got the thing shut down.
Which makes me wonder if I would be better off having my own Facebook account. So
actually, it's the reason that I have a Facebook,
right?
It's
the reason I have one also.
I have it so that I can prove it's me, and if somebody makes a fake one, then it's easier to get rid of it.
I can't say I've had the same experience because Facebook and MySpace and all the other social media sites that we use investigatively-wise have law enforcement compliance centers, kind of like the Verizon and AT&T, and they're, I would say, more than helpful for us when it comes time to what we need. Again, if we provide a certain type of information, but they have these sites set up, and they just walk you through it. You know, then there's the exigent circumstance with certain cases with Facebook and MySpace where, you know, a life-threatening situation, they can access and get you the information right away based on certain aspects that they have that fit into that.
I was just curious with the sites like Facebook and Instagram and some of those, that material that's posted on there, I mean, I've heard different things about whether that's actually, does Facebook now have that, the rights to those pictures, and sell those pictures?
Part of the terms of service.
Yeah, so I mean, you are not...
Same with YouTube, and YouTube is also law enforcement friendly in the fact of you post something on YouTube and we get the URL of the site where it was at. You know, we do a quarter, we can get that video. We can find out when it was uploaded, from what computer, date and time, and all that. But it's their property. Same with Facebook and the photos.
Yeah, they just, Facebook gets just one lawsuit. They got sued by a young lady and won a lawsuit over her photos.
And again,
they
that's
sold it to an advertising agency, a picture of a college girl.
Well, right, and if you saw the video in the beginning, towards the very end, it's no longer we're looking for news are looking for us, but you got to look
right.
at all the different Foursquare and geotagging and Wi-Fi. Why is Wi-Fi free in McDonald's and Starbucks and all that? Because they want to see who is going in there, you know, and they're getting your information as soon as your Wi-Fi connects. Why? It's advertisement-wise. They're learning more and more about you as they are everywhere. You can drive down the street if you have... You know, next you know, an officer saying, you come on in, I got a $10 gift certificate or a $10 coupon if you come in and eat today. Why? Because your phone is active and sending out signal and letting everybody know, and they pick up on that. It's all a big registry of database information that people are collecting to better target the specific audience for what they want. I mean, you know, Starbucks and McDonald's isn't giving free Wi-Fi just for fun of it. It's target audiences, and target audiences that they are using through other sponsors through them to get that information out there. And what better way to get your information than on from your phone, which you are freely giving out when your Wi-Fi is up and running and connecting. You leave a trace when you go, when you leave McDonald's, because your Wi-Fi connected there. I got your MAC address.
And the next time you walk in there, it'll automatically pick it up again.
Yep. Yeah.
Once you go and log in that one first time, every other time you walk back into that same place, it'll automatically pick it up again.
Yeah, I mean, I'm investigating you for a crime, and you say, I was never at the State College Nittany Mall McDonald's. Oh, you weren't. Okay. You know, I get the route, and I get the router information and find out your MAC address is on there, which is what the signature of your Wi-Fi when it stamps on.
So you're, okay, so that's what a MAC address is specific to each. Device has its own
MAC. Just basically an IP address
yes.
to a computer
to
is
a
what
device.
That is to a cell phone or an iPod.
I never have a Wi-Fi. I don't leave, my phone's not on Wi-Fi.
Just like GPS, people turn their GPS off, but is it off? There's a cell phone guy right there. You know, geotagging is interesting, and if you ever heard of XF data, and I was going to show you a slide, but if you just type in the computer, EXIF, E-X-I-F data, on a Google search, you're going to get Jeffrey's EXIF data. Click on it. It's not a frilly page, but it just has a blank where you can have a URL or you can add a file. Click on browser and go in, and let's just say you have photos. You took some photos on your phone or you took photos anywhere else. And when you click on it and you import that and then you say find image, if you have EXIF data on your phone, which I have it turned on my phone, so if I took a photo in this room right now and I downloaded it on the computer and went through Jeffrey's, it would give you the latitude and longitude, the GPS location where I am. It would give you the date and time. It would tell you the phone that I used, which was a Motorola Droid X2, and all the other specific detail about that. And we've used that on numerous investigations. So much so, you gotta look at it this way. If you can get on someone's Facebook page and you can import that photo or take that photo, you can enter it into the EXIF data to find out GPS location, where that could become an issue, a harassment stalking case, someone that you saw years ago that you've moved across country for, and next you know they found you again, at least they found your picture, and you had your EXIF data, the metadata within the photo embedded in there.
And you don't even know, I mean, you don't know this, it doesn't post that.
It doesn't post any of that. That's the, you know, the covert portion of it. And it's really, it's a great, I use it all the time. And when I was down at that class, even though we've done it before, we imported tons of photos. And again, your EXIF has to be on. The geotagging has to be on your phone to imprint that onto the photo. But it works really well. You should try it. And then, what's even better, as soon as you scroll down the page, you don't have to plug in the latitude and longitude because it's going to be on Google Earth. Google Maps, it's going to show you exactly on a map where it's at. You can zoom in and go right to the street, zoom out and find out that it's in Bellefonte. It's great information when it's used properly, but you got to realize it's also great information for bad guys, for predators, for stalking, for pedophiles. You know, you're posting pictures of your kids and there's somebody surfing through the website and say, oh, look at that. And they have these tools at their disposal as well.
That's only pictures taken with a, I don't have a smartphone, I have a notebook, so.
You have a window
licker. Yeah, I guess.
That's all right.
That's a track phone, so, you know what I mean? Like,
nothing wrong with that.
There's nothing wrong with that, you know what?
It's $8 a month, it works for me.
And you can make phone calls, right?
Exactly.
And you can receive phone calls.
However, my son has a smartphone, so he's way ahead.
Again, don't be alarmed by that, but at the same time, you have to have it activated on your phone. But if it is activated, it locks in every, you know.
But that's, so that, what I was going to say, that's only for pictures taken with one of those types of devices, not any other pictures that would be digital.
That's correct, unless you buy a digital camera that also has GPS capability and download.
Samsung has one out there.
I was going to say, I know they're out there. They're a little more on the upper end than a normal digital camera.
$600 digital camera,
right.
But it can be done. You can do take a picture with it and post it on Facebook and do whatever you want with it.
And just so you know,
our video camera. We have a video camera that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I didn't mean to say. It's just not limited to images. It's video as well. You can absolutely get GPS from video. Yeah.
I can access it. I'll tell you exactly where. And that was just by dumb luck that I figured that. I wasn't trying it.
The amount of,
knows I'm in North Carolina.
I mean, the amount of information on these phones is incredible. We're talking about work, you know, and all the work files that you might have on here, and your bank accounts, and your family photos, or work photos, or phone calls you made, or text messages, or websites you visited. Everything.
And that's not even counting cloud services, the stuff that's not on your phone.
I didn't want to get into that.
Yeah.
Now, are there ways besides just hand your phone over, let's take a look? I mean, are there other ways to track sort of either texts or, I don't know. I mean, I know you said about the Apple products, you know, how many accounts.
Well, let's start. If I was to get your phone, and it wasn't password protected right away, I could open up and look at the logical information on there, which is all the stuff that you can scroll through. If it is password protected, I could most likely bypass the password, and then get into the phone, and then get into the physical portion of the phone, which is all your deleted stuff and stuff that you can't access through normal button searches. But then is there another method, are you asking?
Well, I was actually asking, is there a way for me as a parent to know, to other than asking my son that, you know, I mean, I can ask him to do that, but are there other ways for me to have more knowledge of what kinds of things he's doing with his phone, texting with his phone, I mean...
Through communication.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no devices out there that you could purchase that would allow you to see what you can't see by manually searching through his phone. So if he wanted to do something on there and delete it, you're not going to get it. I had an investigation with Officer Steck where there was some suspected drug dealing or drug use with the phone. The mother came in, I paid a bill. That's my son's phone, but I paid a bill. Search it. Yeah.
And I've had that happen several times this year. I've had parents bring me cell phones to the high school and say, here's my phone. I found this on it. Do what you got to do. And a lot of times I'll give them Detective Aston, and we'll dump the contents of the phone, and she prints it out and puts it all in this beautiful little CD. And unfortunately, they're loaded full of drug information. They're loaded full of dates and times and list of people that are buying and where they're making the deals. And that's their life. That's how they communicate. They don't talk anymore. Think to your house. I mean, how much do you talk, you know, to your kids if they get a cell phone? Because they're sitting on their cell phone, probably playing on their phone tonight. And they do the same thing to their friends. And that's their communication source, and that's what they do. And it's made it very, very easy for them and very difficult for us to keep up with a lot of the criminal activity that's taking place. And unfortunately, it is.
I mean, bottom line, as an investigator, it's a wealth of knowledge. When we can get someone's phone, you know, and access through a search warrant or through consent, I don't have to know anything about you at all. I could have your phone, maybe not your phone, anybody else's phone. but believe it or not, even your phone would tell me that. But if I had someone's smartphone and did what I needed to do on it, I mean, you're talking gigabytes of information that are on there, that are stored on there. Tell me how knowledgeable I would be about that person after a couple hours of searching through it. I could learn all their photos, their contacts, their most recent calls. We have programs for forensics that allow the phone to be broke down by the number of calls made, either monthly, daily, by hour, text messages, and obviously the highest is text messaging, followed by phone calls is lower, much lower. I can learn everything about a person from their phone. Their interests, where they've been, what they've done, what they're going to do, doctor's appointments. People have their calendars synced in work to their calendars on their phone. It is absolutely amazing what I can learn through an investigation with a phone. Why? Because they're convenient, they're easy, everybody has one now. They're going down in price, and they're storing more and more information. Everybody's putting everything that they absolutely have on it. Have you seen anybody take a phone and run it under a scanner with the barcode at a store? Yeah, I mean, you don't even need to have all the other cards. You don't have to have your Wise card and all that. You can just put it right on your phone, yeah, through your barcode.
Yeah.
The key ring is another one. You know those little cards you get on your key ring,
yeah,
for a different storage? You can put all that on your phone.
Yeah.
So then you can find out where everyone shops, what they bought.
Now, pretty soon, there'll be an app to start your car, and you won't need a key. It's just, I don't know if that's
on there. The new Samsung phone coming out has got infrared built into it. You can change the TV channel on your remote. It takes over your TV remote.
I know in hotels, I tested this out. You know, when you get in there, changing the channel, they have an app that they tell you on the TV. You can put it onto your phone and change if you want to. So you don't have to use it. That way, while you're looking down, texting, you can also be changing the channel. That way, it's all convenient right there. Everything's on there.
And the flip side of all that, while we enjoy some of these luxuries, the other side of that is that technology is also in the hands of anybody who has that phone of any age. And all they have to do is figure out how to use it. And sometimes it's not always used positively. And that's why, you know, I guess my side was personally from the law enforcement aspect is, as parents, I would ask you really monitor your children's phones and iPods. Because it's the only way you're going to know what they're using them for.
You know, parental controls is great. Now, going back to bullying, I mean, bullying is not a juvenile problem. It's an adult problem. It's an adult issue, how it needs to be handled. You know, with all the bullying that goes on outside of school, what does happen in the school, hopefully, is the reporting. And that's where it needs, it's, you know, it's the intangible. I mean, you have somebody reporting something that happened outside of school. You know, how do you investigate that? Where do you go with that? Where do you start? You know, how serious do you take the complaint? You know, these are all things, these are all pitfalls that have happened over the years. Through a lot of trial and error in these different schools.
Are kids using, I think, come stand on the iPhone, the Find Friend app? Like, I find that just alarming that there's such a thing, but are kids using that?
Yes.
Because I find that like why would you want to have everyone know exactly where you are at all times?
Let me move through here. There's privacy controls. Let me just go through here. Craigslist. What is the one that is we use right now? Is it
Backpage?
Thank you. I'm sorry, I lost that. I don't get on at all. But Backpage is very alarming.
Yes.
This, in short. It's the new Craigslist, so to speak, because Craigslist has a lot of great things on there, you know, for selling goods and a lot of different information. You know, you can sell different things that you can do on Craigslist, but it also allows you, this is in Detroit, I kept it out of this area, you can search and, you know, call services. But Backpage allows for the same thing within State College, Bellefonte, right? It goes by geographic area.
Right.
Let me back up real quick for YouTube. This is 2 billion per day. 2 billion per day. I mean, that's staggering to even think. I've been in State College for many, many years. Officer Stack, a few more years than me. We've been to all of the riots. The 98 riot, we begged, borrowed, and pleaded to get a couple VHS tapes, and maybe we had four or five of them at our disposal to help with our investigation. In 2001, we got a little more lucky. We had 10 to 15 or more of the news agencies provide them to us. The most recent incident we had with the Joe Paterno riot, we didn't have to ask for any video. We just clicked on State College Joe Paterno riot, and there was more than we could even go through. I mean, so in 5 years, look at how an investigation has changed. Those tapes were gold to us back in the day. Now they're meaningless because everything was right there. People were uploading. There's cameras out there that you can, as soon as you press a button, it uploads the YouTube right away. You don't even have to do anything. I mean, obviously your account and stuff like that. So investigations have just changed so drastically for policing over the years with the advent of all this technology.
And just to expand on that, just an example, for our school purposes, last week I had a pretty significant fight at the high school. And within 10 minutes, I had two videos on my phone. There was half a dozen videos of it on cell phone videos. And I had two of them on my phone within 10 minutes of it occurring, which is all the proof you need.
When in doubt,
prosecution purposes.
Check YouTube. You know, again, it's just how you type it in and how you search for it. Moving through here pretty quickly here with MySpace. Again, MySpace was really popular, still popular today, but just it's nowhere near where it was. Twitter. Anybody have a Twitter account? Chat roulette, I was just throwing this out real quick. This is just one of many, many sites out there. I'm not going to go through all the details. But it's a web camera based on chats. We've had some Skype issues in the past where, you know, somebody's Skype is open and people are surfing through Skype and find an open site, and there is, you know, the 14-year-old ready to start their Spanish through an online tutor, and this other person finds them. You know, but this chat roulette works off spins. And eventually, as you scroll down there, you can see approximately 1 in 8 spins reveals a picture of a penis or other objectionable material. These are all sites that are out there. This is just one of hundreds. other social media sites. So I talked about Pinterest, Tumblr, Google Plus, 2011, up and running. It's now, it's number two right now. Foursquare with the geotagging. Did you ever see a lot of the barcode imprints? You know, you can bring your phone right over. Again, geotagging and Foursquare letting you know, hey, you know, you're at Pizza Hut. You put it out on Foursquare, everybody knows you're at Pizza. Facebook does the same thing. Snapchat, Ubu and Skype, they're both voice over IP, very popular on the phones. You know, it used to be on the computer. I mean, it's free, you know. You know, you can go through other countries as far as talking and not have to worry about the phone. What I found interesting, everybody knows Angry Birds. This came out, 1.7 billion downloads on Angry Birds. Who has Angry Birds on their phone? There you go. And Kick Messenger, Text, Free Text Plus, AIM messaging. Remember the old days of AOL and logging in, you know. Implications for law enforcement. Again, I'm going to move through this because of the time here. Covered the bullying. I mean, we could have a PowerPoint on bullying. There's a lot of great information, which I'm assuming the principal has that and all that, with the sites that are on there and the free information on bullying and a lot of the different videos that they have out there. Sexting. Again, sexting hasn't gone away, but Snapchat has certainly made it a little more difficult for us. But it's still there. And the law recently changed, and not to throw anybody on the spot, but in 2000, what was it, 12 in November?
It was just
November. In November, they changed it. In short, it's going down from a felony to, is it a summary?
It's yes, a summary.
Unless it's obscene.
In short, I guess it's this. We're boyfriend and girlfriend. I send you a picture, you send me a picture.
That's a summary.
That's a summary offense. But now you send me a picture, and I show it to Jason.
You send it to someone
now
else.
It's a misdemeanor?
That makes it a misdemeanor. If you send it to somebody else.
That's still a summary,
okay.
Unless that person is over 18, and then it becomes a misdemeanor. It also becomes a misdemeanor if it's something that's lewd or obscene.
Okay.
Just a picture of bare breasts or a penis is not considered lewd or obscene. It has to be some kind of sexual act.
But prior to that, it was basically black and white, felony only.
Correct, because it was considered child pornography.
Right. And that caused a lot of issues.
Nationally, or is that just Pennsylvania? That's Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania. Now, there's a lot of other states that have similar laws.
If it's a misdemeanor, you would become Megan's Law Registered.
So if you should something
if they're over the age of 18, then and you're over the age of 18, then it's
right.
Not a crime.
Right.
It's only when it involves a minor on one
okay.
End or the other. Okay.
Right. But yeah, what we're seeing in the schools for years now has been the sexting. Real quick on the legal portion of it with, and there's a lot of slides here, but the seizing of information and how we can get certain information. We have preservation of records. And how it works for certain investigations, I mean, we can always go back with an investigation, with a bullying investigation or a sexting investigation. Obviously, the sooner we know, the better it is for preservation of records, because a lot of these records that are out there that we need are only held for a certain amount of time, 90 days and so forth. Emergency disclosures, again, briefly talked about that, where Facebook and YouTube and all that, you have to have the proper legal process, but under exigent circumstances, you absolutely can get in touch with their law enforcement hotline to get that information as soon as possible. Some of the dangers for kids, and it keeps on going. The perverted justice, the Dateline, with all the sting operations you've seen in the past on that, they've made the headlines for years. Best practices for parents. You know, it used to be, you know, where to put the computer, but now, you know, where's the person's smartphone or where's their iPod? When they go to bed at night, Officer Steck said exactly that. You know, it's the computer age is over. It's the tablets, it's the iPhones, it's the smartphones, and it brings up a whole new realm of questions of how as parents, how as administrators, how as police officers, how as adults monitoring the activity of kids.
And a really simple way to fix that, take all the chargers and put them all in your bedroom and charge all their stuff in your bedroom at night.
How do you know that's what we do?
Yeah.
Now that's a really simple way, and that's what we do.
Yeah.
We have the white cord in our room, and that's where my son's iPod gets charged. Now, do we do it 7 days a week every time? No, but we try. Now, he's a lot younger. What am I going to do when all my kids reach up the high school age where I'm juggling all this? But you're right, that's a great way of doing it.
They have those little power mats now. You can just stick more.
You're right.
So.
In short, it's basically next to impossible to monitor everything that's going on. You had a good chance back in the, when you had a laptop or you had a PC at home. You don't have that now. Now I think it goes back into, you know, communicating, talking to your kids, understanding what they're doing. If you're paying the bill, you should have full access to that phone to include the password. I understand privacy, but it's the same way, and I say this for all the drug cases we do. You know, if they live under your roof and they have a room in your house and you have full access to that bedroom and allowed to search it anytime you want, spot checking.
And I read something today that was just a psychologist or something said, if a child wants privacy, tell them to write it down in a journal and stick it under the mattress in their bedroom. Because otherwise, it's all yours.
Well, you have to be involved and you have to know what's going on. And the problem now with the access to phones and how they can communicate, you don't know who they're communicating with nowadays. There's just so much out there that they can deal with and talk to. I've had incidents where, with the text-free and all that, they're talking to people that aren't anywhere in this area. They're from a different state. And that's all it is right now, is an online type of chat. But who knows what it's going to turn into. I've also watched the evolution of these online chats, or these online messaging, through text messaging, for example, one case I had last year, where it started off very, very genuine, and it evolved. And when it evolved, it obviously evolved to naked photos. So there's a lot of different things out there. There's a lot of dangers for kids. To be aware of it's one thing, to be involved is another. You just have to realize that in this day and age, you're not going to be able to cover all the bases. So, I mean, it's just, it's constantly updating yourself and communicating with the kids. I think the schools are doing a great job. The school resource officers are well aware of all the things that are going on. Like I said, Officer Steck and Officer Brower, they deal with this on a daily basis, and it doesn't even get fielded up through me as a detective. They handle a lot of this in school with the administrators that is going on, way more than I'm even aware of. There's a lot more slides to go into some of the more of the legal portions of it, but it's 8:40 now. Does anybody have any other ending questions here? Any comments or questions about the presentation? There's a lot of great questions tonight. I appreciate everybody being here.
Thank you.
Yeah, I really appreciate it. A lot of great
questions.
You
can always stop down. We'll answer. I'll sit there and answer any questions anytime.
I'll take you up on that.
Please do.
I use them on about a weekly basis.
Yeah, every week or two.
I
how do you do this? And I kind of Google it real quick and say, okay, this you need to do this, this, and this. And,
I would tell you,
I'm
behind the ball on technology. I don't have nearly the training or expertise that Detective Aston has, which is why we asked him to come to this presentation more than me. So, like I said before, I a lot of times I rely on the kids if I'm looking for something in particular, but if it's investigative purposes, sometimes we have to tap sources we have. But in closing, I guess on my end of this, I would really just ask that you spread the word to fellow parents. I wish we would have had more people come to see this, because I think this is there are a lot of people don't understand the issues that can arise just from a simple iPod, a simple telephone, cell phone. It's huge. There's tons and tons and tons of things that can be done on there. Most of it's free, and they don't need your permission to get it. And if you're not checking, you're not going to know what they're doing. So, I am just telling parents, you've got to be looking at these cell phones. If you're paying for it, you have the right to look at it. Then once you look at it, shut it off for a little while.
You can temporarily suspend an account. You don't have to shut it off permanently. You can call Verizon, I think AT&T does this too. You can say, I want that phone turned off for a month. You can shut it down for a month and say, okay, turn it back on.
My guess is a week, you'll have access to that phone.
Yeah.
3 days.
Not even
3 days. And you'll get whatever you want.
Just real quick on the
board, there's the email addresses for all three of us. Yours is
that's
still
that's correct.
Yeah. So if you have any other questions, certainly yes, shoot an email to any of us. That's the old way of communicating, email.
I was going to say, the slide before that had some other...
Yes. We just ran out of time here. A lot of different resources out there. NetSmart and Stay Safe, Wire for Safety, Cyberbullying. And these are, again, just scratching the surface, a lot of them out there. Again, you know, you can't not look at Google and just typing in what you're definitely searching for. You're going to find all these and more.
Just a screen capture.
And there you go.
Feel free, if any of you have questions, feel free to contact them by email. If I can't answer the question, I would certainly contact one of these two gentlemen to get us the answer. So you'll find my email on the school website, and you can access that anytime. And obviously, with technology, I get my emails via cell phone, so I get them anytime, anywhere. So feel free to contact them.
And this is going on the website, so if you have friends who couldn't be here tonight.
Yeah, I believe once we go through this, we will be putting it onto the website, yes.
All right, well, thank you, everyone. I really appreciate it. It went a little longer than slated, but thank you again for the great questions.